بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله اللهم صل على محمد النبي وأزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وذريته وآل بيته كما صليت على آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. Dear brothers and sisters, this is a continuation of a topic we started 2 Jumu'ah ago when we were talking about Surah Al-Kahf. Surah Al-Kahf, as we mentioned before, it's important to be recited in every Jumu'ah, like today. And it is mentioned in the Ahadith, multiple Ahadith, that whoever recites Surah Al-Kahf in Jumu'ah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him light that would take him to the next Jumu'ah. And it will also be a protection for him from the trial of the Dajjal. And the trial of the Dajjal is the biggest trial to come to earth for those people who are going to be exposed to it, of course. So if Surah Al-Kahf, knowing it, understanding it, memorizing it, is a rescue for us from the trial of the Dajjal, we can imagine that if we understand this surah and apply it in our lives, it will save us from the trials that are less than a trial of the Dajjal, like the daily trials that we are exposed to now. The point I stressed upon the first khutbah in this topic is that a human being should submit to the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and should realize that his knowledge is limited. Us as human beings, our knowledge is so limited. That is why we have to rely on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us through the Quran and through the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because we don't really know what is best for us or for our families or for our nation, for our communities. We don't know. But when we follow what we are told to do and what we are recommended to do through the Quran and Sunnah, we are guaranteed that we have done the best and that we are safe. فَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِمَّا يَنْكُ مِنِّي هُدًى فَمَنْ اتَّبَعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنكًا وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. This ayah, Allah says to humanity after he descended Adam to this earth and his wife, he says, فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُم مِّنِّي هُدًى, whenever you receive my hidayah, my guidance, فَمَنْ اتَّبَعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى. Whoever follows this guidance, لَا يَضِلُّ, he will not go wrong. لَا يَضِلُّ, ضَلَال means to go wrong, to deviate. وَلَا يَشْقَى, شَقَى is misery. He will not go wrong and he will not suffer. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي, and those who ignore, deny, reject, get the opposite. فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنكًا, then he lives in misery and everything is going wrong. وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى, and even in the day of judgment he comes blind. He is resurrected in a state of blindness. And he says, قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا. He says, oh Allah, why am I resurrected blind while I had my sight in this dunya? This is not a social gathering. This is for the Jumu'ah. Okay? Come here. And also, you guys, please don't talk. And you're not allowed to drink. Please, put that glass down. He says, كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. He says, just like you ignored my ayat and you acted blind to the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during this life, then the punishment is the same. You get resurrected in a state of blindness.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of Surah Al-Kahf guides us to the fact that Allah's knowledge is unlimited. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything and anything that existed and will exist, and even that does not exist, if it exists, how it would look like and how it would be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the end of Surah Al-Kahf, قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ الْبَحْرُ مِدَادًا لِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّي لَنَفِدَ الْبَحْرُ قَبْلَ أَنْ تَنْفَدَ كَلِمَاتُ رَبِّي وَلَوْ جِئْنَا بِمِثْلِهِ مَدَدًا. He says, if all the oceans were used as ink to write down the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and kalimat could mean the words that describe Allah and His knowledge, or the words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to manage this universe. Because everything is managed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this management is not through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all He needs to do is just say for the thing to be and it becomes. إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. So these are the words of Allah, kalimat. So what is the meaning of kalimat Rabbi here? The kalimat Rabbi means the words that come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to manage this universe. Just like Allah said in Surah Al-Rahman, كُلَّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ. Every day He's managing different affairs. كُلَّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ. Because every day is different from the day before. Every moment is different from the moment before in this universe. And this is just a universe that we recognize. We don't know about the worlds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created and is creating everywhere else beyond our knowledge. So, if someone wanted to write these kalimat, all the oceans in the earth would not be sufficient, even if you keep on repeating them. وَلَوْ جِئْنَا بِمِثْلِهِ مَدَدًا. And also, if you want to describe the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can finish all the oceans and keep on repeating and it will not finish. So, we have to rely on the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And based on this knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah tells us that certain things seem in a certain way in our eyes, but in reality they are different in the knowledge of Allah and His sight. In the sight of Allah, things are different from what we see them. And what are we required to do? We are required to view things according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described for us. If we look at something and we look at it and we think it is beautiful, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that it is only beautiful on the outside, but in the inside it's so terrible. But we cannot see the inside. What do we have to do? We have to accept the knowledge of Allah on this matter. If we look at something and we feel that we like it, and it is good for us, but then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that it is bad for us, what do we have to do? We have to acknowledge that it is bad for us and understand that and believe in that and act accordingly. Now, just like Allah says in the Quran, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ وَهُوَ كُرْهٌ لَكُمْ. Qital, fighting, has been made an obligation upon Muslims in certain ways, right? In certain circumstances. But who wants to fight? Who wants to lose their life? Or who wants to get injured? Who wants to lose a limb or an eye or an ear or a nose? Who wants to suffer the pain, the misery, the loss? Who wants to put the money? Nobody wants these things. Correct? In our eyes, we hate all these things. Allah says, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ وَهُوَ كُرْهٌ لَكُمْ. But then Allah says, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. He says, maybe you hate something, but it is for your best. We are avoiding it, but eventually, if we don't do it, then we have more pain than what we would have had if we applied it. Many things like this. Just like in this surah, Allah says about the dunya, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَعَ الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah has made the dunya beautiful, but He has made it zina, beautiful on the outside. But again, it is not for pleasure. It is for trial. لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ. So now we have to view the dunya with all its beauty, with all its attraction. We have to view it in this way, that it is a trial for us. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the dunya, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ. In the same surah, فَأَصْبَحَ عَشِيمًا تَذْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُقْتَدِرًا. He says, give them this example of the dunya. Just like when the rain comes down and then the crop comes out from the earth, and then the crop doesn't last for too long. Even especially in this country, if you look at the crops, they come out maybe in June Maybe they start coming out in June or July. And then by September, they're ripe. And if you don't harvest, and I talk to a lot of farmers, if you don't harvest quickly, during September, you're gone. Your crop is all gone. And this is the same example of this dunya. Allah tells us that, just like the crop that comes out from the earth, it does not last long. It comes out and it looks very beautiful. And it looks so beautiful in the eyes to see all these flowers coming out, or the grain, the wheat coming out, or different kind of crops. It looks so beautiful and it's very attractive, but then it does not last. It ends quite quickly. So this is another example Allah is giving us on how to view the dunya in this surah, because this is one of the trials that we are exposed to. How can we pass these trials if we don't view things like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to view them? قُلْ قَوْلِ هَذَا سَفْرُ اللَّهِ سُّلِهِ وَلَهُ بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد, this is just from this surah. Also in the same surah Allah said المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. Again, money and wealth and prosperity, and بنون, big families, children, زينة الحياة الدنيا. Again, it is one of the زينة, attractions of this dunya. وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ خَيْرٌ. So, we look at our money and our wealth, it attracts us. But then comes our salah, our dhikr, our Qur'an, difficult on us. Our siyam, difficult. We don't see that, we don't feel the same attraction to these things that we feel for our dunya. Correct, we are human beings. Our food and everything that we like, we're attracted to this. But who actually is attracted to siyam? Attracted, has an attraction to it. It's very difficult. Yes, some people can reach this level when they have dedicated themselves so much to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah makes even the most tough ibadah becomes very beautiful in their eyes. They can't live without it. But we're not at this stage, to be honest. We have to be honest with ourselves. We are not at this stage, or not even near it. We have to do mujahada. We have to work on ourselves. We have to push ourselves. Remember the nights when we had to come here for tahajjud? Huh? How many times we have to decide and have to push yourself? Oh, I'm so tired. No, I'll pass today. Huh? Well, that's so difficult. Because we have not reached that state where the ibadah has become an attraction. So, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is better for us. وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ خَيْرٌ. بَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ by the dhikr, خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ أَمَلًا. It is best for you, and it's best reward when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, and this is why, since the dunya is not meant for pleasure, it is meant for trial. We looked at the example mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about the man who had two gardens, two big farms, two big gardens. And it was two men. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا رَجُلَيْنِ, two men. And everyone, if we look at with our eyes, would have thought that two men and two farms, that in each one of them gets one farm. This is how we would think it would be. Because we don't see things like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to see. But he says, جَعَلْنَا لِأَحَدِهِمَا جَنَّتَيْنَ. I only gave one of them the two gardens, subhanAllah. Two gardens and two men, only one of them gets the two gardens. Because this dunya is not meant for pleasure. It is meant for trial. To some people higher than others. Some people rich and some people poor. Some people strong and some people weak, so that there's a trial. وَجَعَلْنَا بَعْضَكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ فِتْنَةً. To trial you. So Allah says that the one who has the two gardens, is he going to be nice and kind to the one who doesn't have any? Is he going to be arrogant and feel that he has something, that he's better than the other guy who didn't get anything? And this is exactly what happened. He failed in this test, as you know, in the surah. But this other man, yes, he didn't have money or wealth, but he had the iman. And he was not shaken by the fact that this man was more rich than him. He was not shaken at all. And this man was boasting and, you know, and bragging about his two gardens. قال ما أظن أن تبيني هذه أبدا وما أظن الساعة قائمة ولددت إلى ربي لجنة خيرا منها منقلبا. قال له صاحبه وهو يحرر أكفرت بالذي خلقك. He says, have you become a kafir? Can't you see that this was given to you by Allah? أكفرت بالذي خلقك. Have you become a kafir denying your Lord الذي خلقك, who has created you من تراب ثم من نطفة, from earth and then from نطفة, then from a drop, ثم سواك رجلا, then he made you a man standing in front of me like this. لكن هو الله ربي ولا أشرك بربي أحدا. He says, but I know my Lord, I recognize my Lord, ولا أشرك بربي أحدا, and I don't associate in worship with him at all. And then he warned him, ولولا إذ دخلت جنتك قلت ما شاء الله. But this other guy didn't listen, so he was destroyed eventually. And also the trial of the people of Quraysh when they saw that the poor men were sitting with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they just felt that it is not appropriate for those poor people to sit with them in the same place. They said, if you want us, the leaders of Quraysh, if you want us to become believers and follow you, we have to have a separate, class, a separate session, because we are at a different level than those poor people. Correct? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted those leaders to become believers, because if those leaders come into Islam, many thousands of people will fall into Islam. Correct? But this is not how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted things. No, you come into Islam based on recognizing and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you're not allowed to think that you are better than anyone else in Islam. You're not allowed to. It's haram. Al-kibr, to be arrogant, is not accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from a human being. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, no, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاةِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَهُ وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ عَنْ ذِكْرِنَا وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. He says, no, you stay with those people who are poor, who came to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willingly, without any demands, without any conditions. They came because they knew the need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they fear Allah, they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those are the ones you stay with. Do not, لا تعدوا عينك عنهم, do not look at the others. تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Allah is saying to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, do you want the dunya or what? تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. He did not want the dunya. All he wanted is for those people to become believers so that thousands of people come after them. But Allah says, this is not how Islam works. It doesn't go by the value of dunya. It only goes by the values of akhirah. He said, تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. And then Allah says, وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. Say to them, this is the truth from your Lord. This is how it is. Without any conditions, you accept it or not. فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ إِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ نَارًا أَحَاطَ بِهِمْ سُرَادِقُهَا. Then if you want to disbelieve, reject, you can disbelieve and reject. But remember, إِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ نَارًا أَحَاطَ بِهِمْ سُرَادِقُهَا. Just remember that there's a hellfire waiting for those ظالمين who reject. Now, inshallah, we'll stop here because we've already had two khutbah today. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه, وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم أرنا الأشياء على حقيقتها, اللهم أرنا الأشياء على حقيقتها, اللهم ارزقنا تتبع مواطن رضاك. اللهم أرنا الأشياء على حقيقتها, وحبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا, وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان, واجعلنا من الراشدين. ونسألك مثل ذلك لآبائنا وأمهاتنا, ونسألك ربنا النصر على الأعداء. اللهم نسألك في هذا اليوم العظيم النصر على الأعداء. اللهم طهر بلاد المسلمين من الكافرين والمنافقين وأعداء الدين. اللهم طهر بلاد المسلمين من الكافرين والمنافقين وأعداء الدين. اللهم انصر من نصر دينك, اللهم انصر من نصر دينك, اللهم انصر دينك وكتابك وسنة نبيك وعبادك الصالحين. اللهم انصر دينك وكتابك وسنة نبيك وعبادك الصالحين. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة, ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. اللهم اجعل عملنا كله صالحا ولوجهك الكريم خالصا, ولا تجعل فيه شيئا لأحد أبدا. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد. رحمه الله.
الله أكبر 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 الله